It's a great pleasure being here and talking a bit about the question, really, what's in our packaging. And I'm really delighted to share a bit of our results on toxicity, especially leaching from food contact materials with a particular focus on plastics. So what's the challenge? Just to settle the ground a bit this morning, when you walk down the aisles of the supermarkets, you find quite many products containing that nice green label or similar labels. It says BPA-free, it does not contain bisphenol A. And what I like about the label also, it concludes that it's non-toxic, so it's 100% safe. Great thing, so we're giving like the public a very good feeling about those products. So they can think like we've gotten rid of a very bad compound, everything's safe for us, so we have accomplished our mission. But of course, you would not sit in that room if you would believe in that kind of safety statement over here. And just to frame the problem a bit better, we all know that BPA is merely the flag on the peak of the iceberg here, and we're talking about chemical complexity. Xenia Groh made that quite obvious with their work. So we're talking about a complex chemical mixture we're using, and this is like BPA is the tip of that. And then we know a little bit about the chemicals associated with food contact materials, but of course we have everything that's hidden underneath the surface here. We don't know how large that chunk of the iceberg is really, and that's the challenge that we all have to deal with, right? And just to highlight that again, I mean, it's a problem for consumers. Of course they have learned about BPA in the news and they have seen the flag, but of course they are pretty unaware of what that iceberg, that chemical iceberg really is. It's a problem for academics, and I will talk about that in my presentation. But just to highlight again, we are all in the same boat over here, and when we talk about NIAS, the non-intentionally added substances, certainly also the manufacturers of food contact materials have an issue with that, right? So just to highlight again, we are in the same boat dealing with that iceberg. We have ways of looking at that iceberg, and we can use a target chemical analysis to look at the chemicals that are migrating from food contact materials, and that will give us a better understanding on what's on top of the surface over here. And Xenia already talked about that in her presentation. We can use bioassays really to look at the biological effects at the toxicity leaching from food contact materials. And the beauty of those assays really is that they give us, when we perform like whole leachate testing, they give us an integrated information on the toxicity coming from the food contact material, and that includes the known compounds, but it also includes the unknown compounds, and it integrates also mixture effects. And we can combine those tools really to understand the iceberg better and to bring more to the surface what we want to know about food contact materials. In our work, we've been using this bioassay-based approach for a range of food contact materials. So we've been looking at leachates from bottles, from baby bottles and drinking bottles. We've also used that to look at baby toys made of plastic, and recently we've been looking into cosmetics and thermal papers used in cashier receipts. And in all those assays, we've been focusing on endocrine-disrupting chemicals, which are compounds that interfere with hormone signaling and hormone function. We focus on estrogenicity and anti-androgenic mechanisms of action. And in some cases, we also use what we called effect-directed analysis to identify the endocrine-disrupting compounds leaching from those products. So, and I want to talk about two case studies in this presentation, not focusing on these examples, but going maybe a bit back in my history, with the first one talking about bottled water. So back in 2013, we published results from a bioassay-based study where we showed that the majority of bottled waters we looked at contained compounds that inhibit the human estrogen receptor alpha, so they're anti-estrogenic, endocrine active, and they also inhibit the human androgen receptor, another hormone receptor, so they clearly contain what we would consider endocrine-disrupting chemicals in the way we frame the problem. And we've did effect-directed analysis on those endocrine-active samples, And we came up with a very funny compound, which is a fumarate. We call it DEHF, diethylhexyl fumarate. Actually, there were no standards for that compound available at that time, so we had to synthesize those chemicals to be able to test that, and that's quite challenging and demands resources. And then we tested that pure compound in vitro again, and we've been able to show that it's anti-estrogenic. So it partly explains the activity that we observed in the bottled water. However, that compound wasn't anti-androgenic, so it barely explains, again, the toxicity that we are observing in our bioassay. So there's certainly some part of the iceberg that we're not understanding. And back in the days, there was no information available on that compound. We've been speculated that it is used as a surfactant in some kind of industrial process of bottling the water, because that was the only function we know. And I went back over the weekend to the ECHA database and looked for our compound here. And now information on the use is available. And what I found quite interesting is that it's also used as an intermediate in the production of thermoplastics. So I'm quite certain it's not leaching from the PET material itself, but it might be used in the production as an intermediate of the lid material, which is another polymer. But that's just hypothetical, really. So I told you that the DEHF really does not explain a lot of the toxicity we are observing in vitro. So something we are doing is called effect-directed analysis. So we take a very toxic, a very active sample, and then we separate the chemical mixture using chromatography. And this is a bit blurry, sorry for that. But you separate the complex chemical mixture, and then you do the bioassays again, and you look for the fraction that contains the toxicity you're interested in. So for a very active bottled water extract, we found like two peaks of anti-androgenicity here, and that tells us that there's two compounds at least in there that act as anti-androgens. And we used the most active fraction over there, and we did something we call non-target high-resolution mass spectrometry. So we were not looking for specific compounds, but we were just screening what chemicals can we find in that active fraction. And we found about 618 chemicals in that active fraction alone, just to highlight the challenges. So those are really fancy machines, they're super sensitive, and they tell you, I mean, a lot about those chemicals, right? But then 618 chemicals, so which one is the anti-androgen here? So we did some chemoinformatics, and we compared the chemical signatures of our active fraction to the fractions that were not active, inactive next to it, and to our surprise, there was only one chemical that was unique to the active fraction. And the mass spec gives us some information, even though it's non-targeted, so we know the accurate mass of that compound, and from that we can derive the elemental composition, so we know it's a C20H28O2 compound. So that's some piece of information we can work with. And then we went to publicly available databases and looked for that chemical composition. Unfortunately, in ChemSpider, you find about 916 different hits, so there's 916 chemicals that have that elemental composition. So again, we're hitting like a dead end here, and this is where we are now. We're doing NMR analysis on our compound now, because NMR is the only technology that really enables you to identify unknown chemicals, but you need like very high amounts of compound and you need very pure samples, and clearly that's not what you're getting when you look at foodstuff and beverages. So it's a bit of a detective's work, and I just will add a fun fact to this kind of quest for endocrine disruptors in bottled water. A colleague of mine is doing a non-target screening in the River Rhine in Germany, and he's doing online measurements. And he has seen the same compound with the same accurate mass and the same retention time popping up in the River Rhine. And quite interestingly, his sampling site is next to a manufacturing plant of a major chemical producer in Germany. So somebody is producing that compound in amounts high enough it is detectable in the River Rhine. So you see detective work that makes it really interesting. But, of course, you clearly see the limitations of finding unknown chemicals. So I just want to move to the second case study, and I want to talk a bit about work that we did on plastic packaging, but other, and also other plastic products. And this is all work done by Lisa Zimmermann from my lab, and she's in the room today. Very happy she's here. And if you have specific questions, just talk to her during the break, so she did all that. So what we've been doing is we've been looking at a broad range of plastic consumer products, including food contact materials, so food trays, yogurt cups, drinking bottles, cling films, and we've also looked at other packaging for cosmetics, for example, and some fun other products. And the idea of our study was not so much to look at the toxicity coming from the individual product, so we didn't want to single out one product, but we selected our 44 samples in a way that they cover the commodity polymers that we're using. And our idea was that we know that higher amounts of additives are used in those materials, polyurethanes and PVC. And the idea was then, of course, that we see more toxicity in the in the plastics that contain more additives. And the idea behind that was further that we wanted to classify the different materials, because it would be great if we could say, like, one material is safer or better than the other. So that was the premise we worked on. We also included, just for fun, to look a bit in the future, bio-based materials. Market shares are still very low, but we were interested what's going on with bioplastics, so-called bioplastics, and we looked at polylactic acid here. So what Lisa did is she cut those products into pieces and she extracted it using solvents as a worst-case scenario. Again, we didn't weren't interested what's really realistic in leaching at that point. But we just wanted to know what is in our plastics. And then we performed a range of in vitro bioassays for general toxicity, baseline toxicity, induction of oxidative stress, and then the endocrine endpoints, estrogenicity and anti-androgenicity. And we combined that with chemical analysis, and this time we did non-targeted GC-QTOF MS, because when you use a gas chromatograph, you have very good chemical databases and you can tentatively identify the compounds. So here are some results. If we look at the induction of oxidative stress in vitro by leachates from plastics, you see a quite nice picture. So according to our hypothesis, you see like that PVC and polyurethane materials induce quite a high level of oxidative stress compounds. And that might have to do with the high amount of additives that's used in there. But you also see popping up in the other categories products that induce oxidative stress in vitro. So for example, a food tray that is made from polystyrene, a yogurt cup from polypropylene. This is a candy packaging. And interestingly, also a PET material that is used in an oven bag. So they clearly contain chemicals that induce oxidative stress. If we look at the endocrine disruptors, so this is just the case for anti-androgenic activity, you see a similar picture over here. So the PVC and polyurethanes are quite potent in inhibiting the human androgen receptor. There is one food contact material, a cling film in here. The other ones are not food contact materials. Again, the yogurt cup from polypropylene pops up and we have a polyethylene bag. So there's also endocrine disrupting chemicals in the plastics that we're using every day. We were interested in the question whether food contact materials contain less toxicity than non-food contact materials. So this is just a plot where we distinguish between the two categories. And we were able to see a difference for oxidative stress induction. So non-food contact materials induced more oxidative stress than food contact materials. That's a good news. So actually, food contact materials are better in that term. We saw the same for anti-androgenicity. We couldn't conclude on the estrogenic activity because it was overall very low. What is striking to me is that if we look at baseline toxicity, so non-specific toxicity, food contact materials contain the same amount of toxicity as non-food contact materials. So maybe that's something we want to focus on in the future. Let's talk a bit about the non-target chemical analysis. So in our GC data, we found between 10 and 120 compounds per sample. The PVC samples, one of them had 200 peaks, so it's quite a lot of chemicals in those plastics we are able to detect. In total, we found like 1,812 compounds using GC-MS. And just to highlight the iceberg problem again, only about 12%, so 218 of those compounds we could find in a chemical database, which is called NIST, to identify the compounds. So of all the chemicals that we are able to really detect in plastics, it's 12% that we can with some certainty identify. The rest, we don't know. We're interested in mapping the chemical landscape a bit. So Lisa was data mining in PubChem, and we looked at TSCA data available for the chemicals we found to look for the function. And the landscape looks a bit like messy here. So we found food additives and contaminants, which are certainly coming from the foodstuff and not from the packaging. But we also found chemicals associated with the packaging material. That's the blue boxes here. So it's solvents, it's intermediates, it's surfactants, lubricants, and of course plasticizers. So you see, like, the landscape is quite diverse. So what we are finding in our plastic materials. So that's quite a nice exercise just to get an overview. But the TSCA data that's available in PubChem is not really useful. So it's just like gives you an overview of what's being used. So this is where we took a food packaging forms work, and we were really, really happy to see that database. So we used their database and cross-referenced it with the chemicals that we found in plastic. And I don't want to go into detail here, but you see quite interesting patterns emerging. We found 19 compounds that we measured detected in plastics that are certainly associated with plastic packaging, and 27 chemicals that are possibly associated with plastic packaging. But we also, in our empirical data, we find compounds that are on those lists but are not known to be used in food contact materials. Nonetheless, we detect them in food contact materials, so it's quite nice to just like overlay the empirical data with those like data based on publicly available information. Finally, of course, we were interested in the toxicity of our chemicals. So what Lisa did here is she looked at ToxCast toxicity data. That's data coming from high throughput screens performed in the US. And we will hear more about them later today. For us, it was just useful to classify and prioritize the chemicals we detected according to toxicity, right? So because we were interested which chemicals we detected matched the toxicity we see in our bioassays. And we come up with a list, and this is the example here for estrogenic activity, because most of the information is available on that endpoint. And we can just like prioritize our compounds. And you find like, usual suspects or old friends here. So that's benzophenone that we detected in PVC. It's used as an antioxidant. It's estrogenic. We detect that in one sample. You find butylated hydroxyl toluene. We found that in PP, polypropylene, and in polyurethanes, another antioxidant known to be estrogenic. And here's another old friend, so that's the styrene monomer. We detected that in all polystyrene samples. In vitro, it's also estrogenic, so you find like quite known, well-known compounds. A flame retardant over here, 3-ethyl phosphate. We detected that also in polyurethane. But what's interesting to me is that we also, on our list of ToxCast toxicity data, we have quite many octadecanoic acids, especially associated with polylactic acid materials. So that might maybe also something we need to look at in the future. So what's the picture overall from that exercise? So we compiled a heat map summarizing all our in vitro data, really. And you see like a very nice picture emerging here. So most of the toxicity is detected in PVC and polyurethanes. And fortunately, they're not used in food contact so often. So our premise that high additive content is also like correlated with leaching toxicity holds somewhat true. To our surprise, we found that the bioplastic, the polylactic acid, has a similar profile when it comes to unspecific toxicity and cytotoxicity as PVC and polyurethane materials. And for me, that is really worrying, because we are talking about regrettable substitutions in terms of BPA a lot. And here, maybe we might substitute a whole material in a very regrettable way. So we need to really look into the bioplastics, the additives, and the toxicity. If you look at the rest of the commodity plastics, really, the the picture is more heterogeneous, right? So PET appears to be quite okay with some exceptions. The HDPE, high-density polyethylene, oh, somewhat okay. For the other polymers, you see a mixed picture. So there's always at least one product that induces a range of toxic responses in vitro. And that's, of course, quite challenging, right? So we cannot say polystyrene is safe, because polystyrene is not polystyrene. It really depends on the product. So that's one message I would take from here. So what are the lessons learned from all those exercises, right? So when we use bioassays to look at the whole toxicity leaching from plastic materials, from food contact materials, from consumer products, they tell us that toxicants are present in those materials, including endocrine disrupting chemicals. If we do the traditional chemical analysis, it tells us that the known compounds barely explain a fraction of the toxicity we're seeing. It's not the bisphenol A, it's not the phthalates, it's other compounds, really, that we need to look for. So my conclusion from that work would be that the human exposure to unknown toxicants is rather relevant, and we really need to pay attention to that. It's a challenge for public health, really, and I just want to come back to my introduction, and that includes all stakeholders. It's not the academics only that can do the fun detectives work, really. We need to work jointly in that, including the manufacturers. And I want to conclude my presentation on a more positive tune, maybe. What we're seeing when we look at traditional materials, polystyrene, for example, some of them contain toxicity, but there's also other polystyrene products available on the market that don't. So we're already using safer alternatives. They're already at the market. So the tricky question now is really, what makes them different from the other products containing toxicity? And with that, I'd like to conclude, and I don't want to conclude that no plastic is fantastic. I would rather say I'm interested in which plastic is fantastic. Thank you.